The recap quiz is about to start. A simple question, be able to answer it in about 30 seconds. I'll give you 1 minute. A function that calls itself is an example of a kind of function. The choices are A is recursive, B iterative, C non-terminating, D mirror. Which of the following is or are false about recursive function? So there could be multiple choices which are false. A must have at least one parameter, B can have only call by value parameters, C may not terminate for some input parameters, D cannot call any function other than itself. For recursion to terminate, the value of parameters A can change in any order, B must move monotonically towards a termination case, C must stay unchanged in all calls to the function, D must never become negative. This is question 4. It is about Virhanka numbers. The question states that Virhanka numbers can be computed A recursively but not iteratively, B iteratively but not recursively, C both iteratively and recursively, and D neither iteratively nor recursively. Again, a simple question. If you have seen the discussion on Virhanka numbers in the slides, you should be able to very quickly answer that. So this is the question 5th of the recap quiz. When a function recursively calls itself, A, the activation record on top of the call stack is popped out. B, a new activation record is pushed in the call stack. C, the activation record on top of the call stack is overwritten. And D, no activation records are pushed or popped. Next quiz. Specifying a termination case. So these are the options. One, there is A, guarantees that a recursive function terminates for all inputs. B, may not cause a recursive function to terminate for all inputs. C, terminates a function if it calls itself. D, helps the compiler avoid generating code for recursive function. So look at this slide now. You all recall this from the lectures?
This function is basically to register quiz 1 and quiz 2 marks as m and n and cipher the marks as 2 power m into 3 power n.
So basically this function is attempting to do the following. It takes those marks. Cipher is some kind of encoding. So basically you want to hide the original information by putting it in some different form. It's called a cipher. So here the new encoding function takes Q1 marks and Q2 marks and then it returns, what does it return, you said, 2 to the power m, and so where are those values of m and n? They are being calculated. Now you will notice that in the function, if Q1 marks equal to 1, you return 6, otherwise you set 2 to the power new encode Q1 marks minus 1 comma 1. So what is happening here? You take the input marks, if they are already 1, you return some value 6, if they are not, you call the same function but multiply the return value by 2 in this case, and then there is a break. So assume some marks and see how many times recursively this function will be called. We will look at some of the slides. So what is the difference between recursion and iteration? Both approaches can be used to solve some sorts of problems. Recursion is a much more powerful expression of your intent. It's also usually a clean expression. It's not that iterative solutions cannot be written very cleanly, but it is not very obvious in some solutions when you use iterative solutions. It is not very obvious that your intent is actually to solve a recursive problem, problem which is by nature recursive. For example, Virhanka numbers, which are traditionally known as Fibonacci numbers, actually have a recursive solution. What is the recursive solution?
nth number is given by fn minus 1 plus fn minus 2. So if you kickstart it with some value of n, two values actually, then you can find successive numbers. Now this is the recursive solution, and the recursive expression is very powerful. However, if you do not have facility in a programming language to implement recursive functions, then you have to implement it using a iterative solution. So how would you do iterative solution? You will start with some old term of the series, old term of the series, add these two to get a new term, and then before going back, you will push the new term to the old term and old term to the old term. Of course, in the correct order, first old term to old term, and then new term to old term, and then go to the new iteration. Now this is artificial. The actual function clearly states f of n is equal to f of n minus 1 plus f of n minus 1. But still it is solved. You will recall that when you have to find out the second largest number of a set of numbers, you adopt a very similar iterative approach. You have a max and second max. You take the first two numbers, compare them and put them into these two variables, and then start an iteration with the third number onwards. So you compare that with the second max first. If the third number is larger, you replace that into the second max. Then you compare second max with max again. And having done that, you go to the next number and so on. That's the iterative solution. You will notice that the nature of that problem and solution is very similar to the Virahanka solution, which has an explicit recursive function. So recursive formulations are usually clean, they are intuitive, and very succinct, very sort of to the point. So here is a set of slides. As I said, some mechanisms of function calls and returns. So recursion is one that will call itself. It's an elegant and natural way, but it is not very obvious as to how such a mechanism gets implemented internally. Please remember again, we are studying these mechanisms just to understand what happens internally. But once we understand that, our implementation, our programs will be much better. As I mentioned earlier also, it is not absolutely critical for all of you to understand how recursion works. But it is useful to understand that, and that is the objective of this exercise. So mutually recursive functions. Function 1 calls function 2, function 2 calls function 3, which calls function 1? What could happen in such a case? So this was the program that we started looking at. A recursive function for encoding marks. The new encode function, which collects question 1 marks and question 2 marks, then depending upon the Q2 marks, it calls new encode recursively if required. So what are the conditions or caveats for using recursive function? Number 1, it must specify how to terminate the recursion. Otherwise you will have an infinite loop of a much greater proportions than what you may otherwise obtain in iterative calls. You must ensure that in any invocation, the recursion changes parameters in an orderly way such that the recursion eventually terminates. Coming back to the recursive function, it is absolutely essential that you ensure that the parameters change in such a way that the recursion eventually terminates. So here is that problem. Encode m comma n is encode m comma n minus 1 into 3 if m and n are greater than 1, or encode m minus 1 comma 1 into 2 if m is greater than 1, n is equal to 1. And it is 2 into 3 equal to 6 if both of them are 1. So this is what that function was trying to implement. Do you see that now? If we go back, do you see such a simple and elegant definition which will implement all of what we just stated? Do you see that? So if, for example, if Q1 marks equal to 1, you return 6, if Q2 marks is equal to 1. So that means both Q1 marks and Q2 marks are 1, you are returning 6, which is 3 into 2. If Q2 mark itself is not 1, then you will have to write in default whatever you would suppose. Otherwise, if it is 1, it tells you what is to be done with Q1 marks. So if it is not 1, then you call it recursively and so on. So this is the termination case. In either case, Q1 marks and Q2 marks. Okay, when M is 1, N is 1, your result should be 6 and you should return. Now you have to change the parameters in an orderly way to ensure termination. You start with M and N, but when you make recursive calls, the parameters must change in an orderly fashion. What is that orderly fashion? The parameters must move towards 1, because only when both of them are 1, you will get out. And you will notice that when you are recursively calling these functions, one recursive call says N minus 1, the other recursive call says M minus. So when one of the parameters reaches 1, you would actually change this one to M minus 1, and therefore that will also reduce. So think of recursion, that how it must change values of parameters so that we move only along a given order monotonically. So for your benefit, Supratik has plotted a grid showing values of M and N. Okay? This is the termination case when M is equal to 1 and N is equal to 1. The starting point may vary depending upon the values of M and N. So suppose this is the value of M and N. That means the first function call is encode 4,3. Now this point where you have in terms of M and N has, after several recursive calls, has to come back to a stage where M and N are 1. The point is, in which fashion do you think the present implementation will cause M and N to change? So how do you move from one red dot to another red dot? Do you move diagonally? Do you go up and down and then come back in circles? How exactly does it happen? And this insight you can get if you analyze the recursive calls for a few values of M and N. Even if you start with this, you first move down. So what does this mean? The value of N is first reduced. And once N assumes the value 1, then the value of M is reduced. Could you have taken the other alternative of first reducing M and then reducing N? Yes, that is possible. They are symmetric alternatives. The point is, you must move in this orderly fashion in order to ensure that the recursion terminates. There is some discussion on recursion versus iteration in the slides. So this is what was stated first. The recursive formulation is usually clean, intuitive, but you need to worry about recursion termination. Again, well-founded ordering of parameter values. Please note that whatever is being stated here in terms of the precaution that you have to take while writing programs, it applies also to iterative solutions that you write. After all, iterative solutions also must terminate. After all, iterative solutions must also have a situation where the condition for iteration termination is progressively reached. And in your program, you ensure that whatever is changing inside the loop causes the termination condition to be approached appropriate. This is, of course, obvious in an iterative loop where you can examine the condition, because you know that there is nothing hidden. There are no previous calls which are not very apparent. Everything is apparent in an iterative solution. But here, you have to imagine what happens when recursion takes. The iterative formulations may be less clean, and they are most certainly less intuitive. Imagine the problem of finding out the second maximum number. It is not intuitively obvious that you can have an iterative solution where you start with max and second max and then keep getting the third value and pushing them into 2. You have to create that situation. Whereas in case of Virahanka numbers, or better known in the Western world as Fibonacci numbers, the recursive solution is natural, is intuitive. Because that is how the solution has been formulated. But you need to worry about the number of recursive calls. Iterative solutions can be clean, but generally they are not very straightforward to understand for other people. And please remember what we said, programs that you write must not only be understood by you and the C compiler, but also by other human beings. So therefore, you might need to put additional explanatory comments to explain how you have built complex iterations. Some similar comments are required in recursive solution implementation as well. But generally, in case of a recursive solution, if you have stated the original problem formulation, which itself is in terms of a recursive formula, then it is more or less straightforward to understand. You always need to worry about loop invariance in iterative formulation, loop variance and termination. Most important thing, iterative solutions could be extremely efficient if formulated correctly. In fact, iterative solutions sometimes may go haywire. There is one particular situation where you are finding out, let us say, factorial n. Factorial n also can be found out recursively. What is the recursive solution for factorial n? F of n is equal to what? Right? This is the recursive solution for factorial. So if you have factorial n minus 1, you multiply it by n, you will get factorial n. And this recursive solution you implement iteratively normally. But you can also write a recursive. So assume that I have written this main program. It's a simple main program. It reads the value of n. It has defined two integer variables n and f. We assume for the time being that the value of both n and the f that we'll compute is within the representation bounds of the int. So that we are not really finding out factorial for very large numbers, so don't bother about that. The point being made is, I want you to write a recursive function fact which will take n as a parameter and will return the value of the final result which will be assigned to f, and you print out. So all that you need to write is so have you written this solution? Let's say you calculate the value in result and return that value. Or you may choose any other variable name, it doesn't matter. Eventually the idea is that you should return the factorial n. Please note that inside the function fact, you are not supposed to use any iteration. The recursive call does not mean that you indicate that you are calling a function recursively, but actually do an iteration inside. You have to recursively call that function itself. This is one solution written by one Tanmay. Says if n is equal to 0, return 1, else return n into factorial n minus 1. The function name is factorial. So what he is doing is, if n is 0, he returns the value 1. Otherwise, returns a value n multiplied by something, and that something is a recursive call to factorial with n minus 1 as the parameter. So do you all think this will work? His question is, if the input is minus 5, then what will happen? Now, let me make some suggestions on this point. Input, any input that is given should be validated at the point where it is given. In fact, that is a very standard coding practice. I also tell you why. Suppose you are writing a function and you don't believe that that fellow has validated the input, then you will put a condition if n less than 0, etc., etc., in your function, which will be recursively examined every time the function is called. Whereas you need to examine that condition exactly once in lifetime, when the function is called for the first time. because subsequently the values are only going to reduce. Further, you might do it doubly because somebody else might have already done it before calling this function from the main program. So while his concern about validation is right, what would happen if this function gets a value which is less than 0, for example? If concern is right, but the correct answer to that concern is, whosoever is reading the value of n for which factorial is to be computed must validate that at the point of input, and then and only then should proceed with the rest of the program. In fact, this is true in general about any input that you read in a program. And it is not uncommon in complex cases, the validation itself is a largely involved process. So you might read, for example, inputs into two arrays, some 7 variables, etc., etc. You actually write a separate function to be called for validation. Later on we will see that much of the data comes in input files. Say for example, your joint entrance exam marks, roll numbers. The validation is required to be done with every record in that file. It is often done separately. Errors are indicated independently, and a file with only correct records is then processed with a program which assumes that the input is valid. So validation is important, but should be done at the point where it is relevant. But other than that, do you all believe that this program will work? So like our friend there, he is extremely cautious and he calculates this, but in his function here, so he is doing exactly the same thing. If n is equal to 0, he is returning 1, otherwise he is returning n into factorial n minus 1. Correct computation, except that he is doing the same thing. If n is less than 0, he outputs an invalid input message and returns minus 1. Otherwise, he does these things. This is correct. But imagine what happens. This function is being called recursively. So every call, you will be examining this condition. Isn't it better to examine this once when you actually read the input here? Because at that point, you know whether things are valid or not. So just as a precaution, do this. But the point I am making is not that. The point I am making is, this is a recursive solution. If you just look at the solution, this appears to be a very clean solution here. If n equals 0, return 1, else return n into factorial n minus 1. Compare this to the iterative solution. This will also find the factorial. Okay, very quickly, if we assume valid input for n, do you think this will work correctly? Yes. Anybody who thinks this is not a correct solution? Everybody thinks it will work. And what was the other solution on the other side? Will this work? Assuming correct values of n? If n is equal to 0, I return 1. If not, I multiply n by a recursive call to whatever value is written by fact n minus 1. Exactly the same thing, right? Now look at both these solutions and comment on both the cost and intuitive clarity. The recursive solution is the one which actually is the original formulation of the factorial problem, whereas the iterative solution is the one which is what we ordinarily implemented. In this particular case, the iterative solution will be far superior in terms of the total amount of computations or comparisons it does. What are the total number of comparisons that this will do and multiplications? For every iteration, it has exactly one multiplication. For implementing the iteration, it will have to increment the value of I in every iteration and has to make one comparison with the terminal value of n. So if there are n minus 1 iterations of the whole thing, then there will be n minus 1 multiplications, n minus 1 increments, and n comparisons starting last one. That is the only work that this program will have to do. Imagine this, it will have to first create an activation record when this function is called first time. Then next time when you call this recursively, it will have to put another activation record on the stack. And then as you complete, you will have to keep returning back. How many activation records will be put on the stack and will be returned? For factorial 4, you will call it factorial 3. For factorial 3, you will call factorial 2. But for factorial 2, again, you will be recursively calling factorial 1. So if n is equal to 5, you can draw actually a tree of calls and find out how many calls are made. All of that results in a correct solution. But the amount of ghodagiri that this second function will have to do is enormous. And these are called overheads. So please remember, recursion comes with large number of overheads. And if the computations involved are relatively simple and straightforward, when the overheads are far more than the meaningful calculations you are doing, it is not worthwhile to use recursion. So you might actually formulate a recursive solution first to intuitively get to know what is to be done, and then examine whether the amount of work involved is so little that an iterative solution is better implemented. All right? So let's go back to the practice problem. To build on the problem that we discussed in the last class, tic-tac-toe. Remember that? This is the winning combination. We assume that 0 is the starting player. We assume that 1 is the second player. So if you go back to this slide, by looking at this combination, you can find out whose chance it is to play next. Simple, you compare the number of zeros and number of ones in a configuration. So you know that the next chance is ones. Do you also not know that one now has a winning combination? Because there are two ones in a line and there is an empty space here. So given any configuration, you can figure out A, whose chance it is to play next, and B, whether at that point in time the person with a chance to play has a winning possibility or not. At least one winning possibility. There may be more than one winning possibility. So this is the winning. Again, to recap, we said that in the tic-tac-toe grid, we represent the grid by a set of 9 integer values. Variables x1, x2, x3, x9, and a configuration represented by this sequence. So for example, here the values which have been put, as we saw in the last slide, are actually 0, 1, 0, etc. But the blank squares of the tic-tac-toe board are represented by minus 1. So at any point in time, the values of x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, x7, x8, x9 will be either minus 1 or 0 or 1. You begin with minus 1 values and you will change only to 0 or 1, so there is no question of any other value being there. So suppose you have to write a C++ function that takes as input an input configuration and determine who should move next. This is the first practice problem. This function is called int next turn. So you have x1, x2, x3, xn. The function definition is given. So check if configuration is valid. Count number of zeros and ones and determine who moves next. This is a sub problem. The name of the function that you have to write is int next turn. Please note that this is neither iterative nor recursive. This is just a function being called only once. It has to take a configuration that has been given in terms of the values of x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x9. if we started with a valid configuration to begin with, then when I call this again and again for different combinations, of course the configuration will be valid, because as I said, the values will be either -1 or 0 or 1. So for the time being, write only those few lines of code which will count numbers of zeros and ones and determine who moves next. There are 9 variables: x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, x7, x8, x9. You have to count the number of zeros and number of ones and determine whether the next turn is 0 or 1. 0 means the first player moves, 1 means the second player. Again, I repeat, it is not an iterative or recursive function. It's a function which comes in with a set of 9 values and returns only one value, 0 or 1. And that value should represent whose turn it is next to move. You will notice that although I said you need not check if the configuration is valid, but during the process of evaluating the count of zeros and ones, you will be examining each and every variable anyway. So you will be able to examine if it is neither 0 nor 1, then it is it -1 or not, and validity can be examined. By the way, the validity will merely mean that the total number of zeros and ones should mismatch at the most by 1. I again repeat, for those of you who are still wondering whether we are talking about iteration or we are talking about recursion, we are talking about neither. We are talking about a plain C++ function to be written with the name next turn. The description of the function is already given. You just have to write code inside these braces. This is also written, just this code. And of course, you have to return a value which should be either 0 or 1. Here is a solution from Lavesh, and I am going to request him to rewrite it, but the general approach is correct. I would like to briefly discuss. So this is his next turn function. We'll ignore the first line and concentrate on what he has tried to write next. He starts with zeros. I do not know why he has equal 0 to zeros. It should be just a single 0. You are assigning the initial value. But look at what he is doing. Is if x1 is 0, the number of zeros are added by 1. Else, if x1 equal to 1, 1s are added by 1. There is no else further, so we do not know the remaining value, whether it is -1 or not, but that is what is assumed, which is okay. But now look at the next one. If x2 equal to 0, zeros are added further. Else, 1s are added. So far, so good. Then I asked him, what is this? Dot, 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 dot. So he said, sir, similar things. Now if I am a C++ compiler, I will try to compile every dot into something. And I will have no choice but to give galis, saying, I can't figure this out. The reason I picked it up is that the logic that he is implementing is correct. But the way he is implementing it is a longish way. What is the faster way of doing this? Somebody says function, somebody says array. This itself is a function. I am trying to write a code which will achieve some computations inside that function. And I don't want to call another function. I want to do all the computations here. Anybody who has thought of a switch statement, somebody else has thought of array. We have not yet discussed the array. We'll do that in the next week when you start working on it. There is nothing wrong with this approach, except that you are not supposed to write dot, dot, dot. So please do the required work and write a complete program quickly. You don't have much time. Sadly, however, that option is not available. This is what you are supposed to do. The function definition is given. What is to be done is explicitly written in terms of three comments. So I think what Lavesh was trying to do at least was to write a solution to this problem. Anybody got it? Bring that solution. Let us listen to the expert advice on the method. Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, if we take one player's input as 1 and one player's input as -1 and the spaces which are not marked as 0 and we add all the inputs, so the result will be means 1 or -1 or 0, then we check the final result and we can say that the configuration is correct or no. The first players we can take 1 and the second players we can take -1.
I am very hazily clear about what you are trying to do, so let me try to expand. You are saying I have 9 inputs x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x9. I simply find sum is equal to x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus x4 plus x9. Fine. What do I do with this sum?
Yeah, so the first, I mean, if we take the first player as 1 and the second player as -1. So if the sum is 1 or 0, so the configuration is correct, or if sum is something else, then the configuration is wrong.
What if I give all the values as -1? That means the first player himself or herself has not yet played.
So no, sir. If the person doesn't play or the box is empty, we take it as 0.
No, they will be -1.
Means I am saying that.
Oh, you are changing the problem?
Yes, sir.
Like our friend, he is solving another problem which he thinks is solvable easily. Unfortunately, my dear friend, in life, such options are rarely available. And imagine if someone says, I want a bicycle, and you say, I only know how to design and build a scooter, so I'll give you a scooter. So that fellow says, I don't have a license to ride a scooter, I need a bicycle. So your solution, however elegant, is completely useless from a practical point of view.
Sir, we can convert all the -1s to 0.
So he will now write a series of 9 ifs to examine each variable and convert it to 0 first, and then he will do his elegant solution. But if I have the liberty to write series of 9 ifs, I will get the solution itself, no? Our friend here says, take all the numbers and wherever there is -1, change it by something else. What is that? A is what? Character A.
When we sum all of them, so we get the ASCII. The ASCII will add. Do mod that ASCII. Whatever the character is.
He has another brilliant solution. He is now using ASCII codes. My question is very simple. This is the function you have to write. What you have been told is this is what you will get. To get the value A, like our friend there, you will also have to write, if x1 equal to -1, then x1 equal to ASCII A. If x2 equal to -1, then x2 equal to ASCII A. You'll have to do that ghodagiri for all the numbers.
No, but instead of defining it -1, we can define it A.
You are changing the problem. When I come to this function, these are the values you have got. Now you do whatever you want to do.
So where have we written that there is -1 for empty space?
We are talking about the input configuration. We have discussed this input configuration earlier. And please note, we are talking about a sub-problem, one of the main problem. I am very happy that you are so creative that you are capable of changing the formulation itself. Unfortunately, in real life, you are required often to solve problems which people pose as problems. We have wasted a lot of time in discussing reformulation of the problem. I will have to sadly stop this discussion, go to the next sub-problem. But please remember this. Please think of solutions in the context of the question, not outside it. You have an option of saying, after solving this problem, alternately I think there is a more brilliant solution which I now write. That is perfectly fine. But that has to be in addition to whatever you are required to do, not in lieu of. Given a configuration, we want to determine if there is a winning or losing move. A winning move of 0, a move of 0 from which there is at least one way for 0 to win, no matter how one plays. Please note, there may be more than one. And winning move of 1 is similarly defined. So please note, this is the next level. You have actually done that earlier part. where you were required to find out whose turn it is. Now, having found that, you want to find out whether there is a winning or losing move to the next player. And how is it defined? Winning move of zero is defined if there is at least one way for zero to win, no matter how one plays. At least one way. The game presumably terminates after one player moves, wins. So here is a configuration. X1 and X3 are 0, X2 and X6 are 1, rest are minus 1. If that is so, then this is the solution. Now next move is that of 0. The winning move of 0 is here. Please note, a winning move is not one which is actually winning, but a winning move is one which is guaranteeing that no matter what the opponent plays next, I will always win. What he is saying is that if I set X5, then also the same situation exists. The problem, please read the problem carefully, from which there is at least one way for zero to win. That's a simpler problem. There may be more than one option, but there has to be at least one way. That is what is required. Now it depends upon in which order you examine the remaining squares. If you examine in this order, then this, then this. So you will first examine this square, then this and this and then this. In which case, when you examine this square and try to say that if I put my zero here, I will get a guaranteed win, then I may not have to do the other thing. If I am examining these in this order, in row order, then I will of course come to this first. And if I come to this first, then I determine that if there is a zero, I have a winning combo. But depends on whichever order you do it. So this is one solution, and this is another solution. So at least two possible winning solutions must exist at that point, out of which the opponent whose turn is next can block at most one. Then only it's a winning solution. So guaranteed win for zero, no matter how one plays. And exactly the same way you can define the situation. Uma, losing move, a move from which there is at least winning one winning move for the opponent. No matter whatever I do, I am going to lose next time. So similarly, this situation, next move is that of one, losing move of one, x6 equal to one. So if I put this here, please note, we start with x1 and x3 is equal to 0 and x2 equal to 1. So only this much has been played and one has to play now. Now if x is placed here, there exists a winning move for 0 subsequently. Therefore, this is a losing move. Please understand, this is how during the analysis of an actual game, the mind backtracks and finds out, if I do this, what may happen next. Okay, so this is the winning move. So if zero has a winning move from a configuration, then after this move is taken, one cannot have a winning move after this. And similarly, same thing with the roles of one and zero is reversed. If zero has a losing move from a configuration, then after this move is taken, one has a winning move from the new configuration. These are the conclusions that you can draw based on. Now this is the sub-problem too. We'll leave it at that. We are already late because we discussed so many alternative brilliant solutions, everyone insisting on changing the problem in one's own way, that we lost a lot of time. So please do that. I don't want to rap on your creativity, but do that independently after the class.